Thank you. evening, everybody. Great to see you in church tonight. Let's all stand, and we're going to sing our theme song together, God is Love. Sing it out with all of your heart.
God is love.
Great to see you in prayer meeting tonight. Number 5-6 in your songbook, The Old Rugged Cross. Think tonight about what the Lord did for you and me.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame.
Oh,
go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to be in church tonight. Lord, we count it as a great privilege. And Lord, we worship you as our God. Father, truly, there's no one like you. You're high and lifted up. You're above all others. You're the one true God. You're holy, holy, holy. And you know all things and you're everywhere. You're our Father. We worship you as God. We praise and thank you for all the many blessings in our life. Lord, thank you that we can be here and Lord, we can worship you. And Father, we thank you especially for this opportunity to remember all of what Christ has done for us. And Lord, we rejoice in that. We praise and thank you for it. We do pray you'd cleanse us, forgive us of all of our sins. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to love you with all of our heart. I pray that you'd be with all, each part of this service tonight. And God, I pray for our deaf as they gather, and I pray for our Spanish. And Lord, I pray you put your anointing in this place tonight. We love you. We praise you. We thank you most of all for the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray in his precious and holy and wonderful name. Amen. And you may be seated. Thanks for being in church tonight. Let's listen to the choir.
Yeah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank God. Thank God for the cross. We're going to have our prayer meeting time. I'm going to go ahead and dismiss choir and orchestra. Y'all can come and be part of the prayer meeting. We have prayer meeting on Thursday night. I think many of you got a prayer list. Bob Murphy is going in tomorrow morning for heart surgery. So we need, he's here. Where's Bob? There he is. Our man Bob is there. And 5:30 a.m., right? All right, so let's pray for Bob. And Karen's here tonight. We'll pray God give them grace. And he's been through heart surgeries before. So we're trusting the Lord to bring him through. And we'll pray about that this evening. Continue to pray for those dealing with cancer. Continue to pray that God would help us. I want you to pray that God would work in the hearts of people who are being invited by our church family, people who have seen a Facebook ad, people that have gotten a direct mailer, people who have gotten a door hanger on their door. Let's pray that the Lord would move in hearts and that God would give us a great number of folks that could come on Sunday and hear the gospel. And as we pray tonight, let's pray for churches around the world that God would bless in all the places where the gospel will be preached, and that there be a great harvest of souls. So if you like to pray at the altar, you can. If you want to pray where you're at, that's fine. You want to pray by yourself, with your family, stand and pray, kneel and pray, sit and pray, whatever you'd like to do. But we're going to go ahead and focus on some prayer at this point in time, all right? And let's confess our sins to the Lord. We'll be right with God tonight. We want to be right with God all the time. But let's go ahead and pray this time. Thank you. Lord, we continue in prayer, asking you to hear us and to help us. Father, you said in your word, call unto me and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. And God, I pray that you would answer according to your will with all the prayers that we're directing to you this evening. God, I do pray for Bob. I pray for the surgery tomorrow morning. God, you're the great physician, so I pray you touch his body and help him and heal him and bring him through it. And Lord, I pray give these doctors and nurses wisdom. And Lord, I pray that you would just bless him. And Lord, I pray you bless Karen, bless their family, give them all grace in the moment. And Lord, we're trusting you. And I pray that you'd bless in the surgery. I pray for those dealing with cancer. I pray you would help them. I pray you'd heal them. Lord, I pray for Joe tonight. I pray you give him grace. Pray for Matt. I pray you'd help Kevin. I pray you'd help others and give them the grace that they need. Lord, I pray for others just not feeling well, that you'd help them and heal them. Pray for college students traveling home. I pray you'd be with them, keep them safe on the roads. Lord, I pray that you would work in the hearts of people all in the South Jersey region. And God, I pray that those who are getting invitations from us would respond and come on Sunday. And Lord, I pray you give us a great number of folks that would come here and put their faith in Christ. And Lord, I pray you'd help our church family as we assemble, that we would be able to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, I pray for other Bible preaching churches in the Northeast, throughout the country, and around the world. I pray you bless the churches. Lord, I pray you grow the churches. And I pray there be a great harvest of souls. Please bless our missionaries around the world. Watch over them, protect them. Lord, I pray you would take care of our church family. I pray you bless our people financially. I pray you bless the offering. And Lord, I pray through this week and on Sunday, you give us a great offering that we'd be able to pay the bills here and take new ground for your honor, for your glory. Lord, we thank you again that we can be here. And I pray continue to help us in the service now. And we pray in Christ's precious and holy and wonderful name. Amen. If you'd like to give online, you can do that, or you can give it to an usher as you leave this evening that'll be standing at the back. Some folks like to mail it into church or bring it by. That's also fine. But we get to give, and we give as unto the Lord, and it's a great privilege to give. If it is your happy birthday week, come on up here on the platform. We're going to sing to you in just a moment. While folks are coming, I'm going to go ahead and remind you on this coming Saturday at 9 a.m. You don't think riding the bus is for you? That's not a problem. But I would love to have a great host of our church family just show up Saturday morning, meet on the school side, 9 o'clock. We'll be loaded and rolling by 9:15. And we're going to go out in the area, plan on an hour and a half to 2 hours max. We'll be back by 11 o'clock, and it'll be a great time. People say, man, what are we going to do with our family on Easter? Let me tell you what would really be great. Go invite somebody out to church so they can come and learn about Jesus. And we had somebody here on Sunday who had gotten an invitation in their door, and they showed up here on Sunday. So people are looking for answers and help. I appreciate Brother Brad. It was a great flyer and the banner and the direct mailer and all that's been going out there. So thank the Lord for that. On Sunday, our services are at 8 and 10:30 and 5:30. All the shareable resources for online at solidrockinfo.org. You can get those. There will not be any Sunday school classes or adult Bible classes on Sunday morning. Don't forget about that. If there's anybody left from the ladies group that has not yet signed up for the renewal, it says sign up online. I didn't even know that we still could or if we can, but we're going to say we can. There's always room in the inn. We'll find a place for you. So if any ladies have not signed up, please do that right away, and Ms. Dawn will contact you. The Ladies Volleyball League is getting ready to crank up May the 10th. So any ladies that would like to sign up, you can sign up online. And the games will run from May the 10th to around the middle of July. Games are at 6 o'clock and 7 o'clock typically. and that's juniors in high school and up. And that would be a great thing. All right. Y'all been up here for 3 days, right?
We're Brother Wayne is turning 80. That's a big number right there, I'll tell you what. So that's an awesome. We allowed to tell on you or no?
I don't care.
50. There you go. 11, 7, and 16. So happy birthday to this crew. Let's sing it out. Ready?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
And let's give them a big hand. Happy birthday. Stand with me, if you would, church. We're going to sing two verses of Saved, Saved. Two verses,
547.
547, says Pastor. We're changing it up, 547. And you tell us what verses you want there. 547, a mighty fortress. First and third. Here we go. Ready?
A mighty fortress is our God.
Verse 3 is the last.
And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim.
One, two, a little loud there. If I get those lights off, thank you, thank you, thank you. If you will turn with me in the Word of God, Matthew chapter number 27, Matthew chapter number 27. And it's hard to see up here. We have a missionary from Guatemala somewhere. Where are you? Stand up. Just stand up. Give your name real loud because I forgot it. We got two of them. Praise the Lord. Tell us your name.
My name is Stephen Richter and my father, Hal Richter.
And he was there, what, 50 years?
58 years in Guatemala.
Wow. And these folks are Bible Presbyterian, Dr. McIntyre's stripe. Thank you for being here. Matthew chapter 27. And I have a very short amount of time here, so you have to listen fast. Verse 33, Matthew chapter 27, and I begin reading verse 33. When they were come to a place called Golgotha, which is to say a place of a skull, they gave him vinegar to drink, mingled with gall, and when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink. And they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots, that might be fulfilled, which was spoken to the prophet, "They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots. And sitting down, they watched him there, and set up over his head his accusation written, 'This is Jesus, the King of the Jews.'" So that's what they were accusing him of, and that's exactly what he was. "Then there were two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and the other on the left. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads and saying, 'Thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself, if thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross. Likewise also the chief priests, mocking him with the scribes and elders, said, he saved others, himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now, if he will have him. For he said, I am the Son of God. The thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land, and unto the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Some of them that stood there, when they heard that, said, this man calls for Elias. And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar and put it on a reed and gave him to drink. The rest said, let us see whether Elias will come to save him. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. Behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent. And the graves were open, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared unto many. Father, please bless this message. Lord, we don't have a lot of time, but I pray, God, that you'll give us something tonight, and I pray you'll touch us. Lord, help us to love you and be thankful, Lord, for who you are and for what you've done and what you're doing and what you're going to do. And we pray this in Jesus' name, amen. I want to preach tonight on what Jesus Christ did on the cross. Now, we know he died, the gospel, 1 Corinthians 15, he died for our sins according to the scriptures, and he was buried and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. But I want to look at the Godward side of Calvary tonight and go back with me to Genesis chapter number 3, all the way back in the first book of the Bible. And in Genesis chapter number 3, the Lord God said to the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. So Satan came into the garden and he tempted the woman, and Adam and Eve sinned, and now God is bringing this judgment. And he says in verse 15, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It, the seed of the woman, shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So right here in the beginning, the book of Genesis, we see this spiritual warfare. We see this spiritual battle between good and evil and between God and Satan. And look with me in Luke chapter 4. I had a little moment there, senior moment. Luke chapter number 4, I'm trying to figure out what to leave out. I want to make this first statement, what he did on the cross. He defeated Satan. On the cross, he defeated the devil. In Luke chapter 4, and he being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. And in those days, he did eat nothing. And when they were ended, he afterward hungered. So think about this now. He comes to Eve, and he beguiles Eve, and Eve sins, and she gives the fruit to Adam, and he sins. So now the devil comes, and he's brazen enough, he's bold enough, that he's going to tempt the Lord and try and get the Lord to sin. And the devil said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, command this stone that it be made bread. And Jesus answered him, saying, it is written, that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. So every time Satan comes and tempts the Lord, he answers with scripture. And think about this, the devil knows just when to tempt somebody, and he knows just how to tempt them. He hasn't eaten for 40 days, and he says, if you're God, then make this stone, turn it into bread. And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will give it. Notice verse 7, if thou therefore will worship me, all shall be thine. So the first thing he says to him is, if you're the Son of God, command this stone to be made bread. Now he says, if you'll worship me, it'll be all yours. So he puts that if in there. Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, him only shalt thou worship. And that's a great verse. We only worship God. And he brought him to Jerusalem, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from hence, if thou be the Son of God. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee. So now Satan's quoting scripture. And in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. And Jesus answering said unto him, it is said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And when the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him, notice, for a season. So here's the devil. He comes in and he tempts the Lord in three ways: the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And that's the way Satan tempts people. And the Lord never did sin. He never sinned one time. Jesus is absolutely sinless. And let me say this, if he had sinned, he would not be able to save us from our sin. He has to be the sinless Son of God. So notice, the devil tempts him, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life, and then he leaves. But notice that phrase, for a season, for a season. You remember the story about Joseph? Potiphar's wife tempted him day by day. Listen, the devil always comes back. The devil always comes back. You say, well, where does he come back? Look over in Luke chapter 23. I said earlier, just a moment ago, the devil knows how to tempt us and he knows when to tempt us. Here's the Lord in Luke chapter 23, and they were come, verse 33, to the place which called Calvary. That's just another language for the place of the skull. And they crucified him there. And notice verse 35, the people stood beholding him, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, he saved others, let him save himself, notice, if he be the Christ, the chosen of God. Does that sound familiar? If he be the Christ. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, if thou be the Son, if thou be the King of the Jews, save thyself. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew, this is the King of the Jews. And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, if thou be Christ, save thyself and us. So three times they said, number one, they said, save yourself. If you be the Christ, verse 35, save yourself. Verse 37, if thou be the King of the Jews, save yourself. Verse 39, if thou be the Christ, save yourself. If Jesus would have got down off the cross, which he could have, he would have saved himself, but he wouldn't have saved us. So he died for us, he died for our sins, and he sacrificed himself. So the devil tries to tempt him, and the devil tries to kill him. I believe when Pharaoh made the decree to kill all the babies, all the Jewish babies back there in Egypt, I believe the devil was behind that. I believe the devil's behind abortion. I believe killing babies is sin. I believe it's murder. Just got to throw that in for nothing. I believe when Herod told the wise men, go find him and come back because I want to worship him, he was going to kill him. He had all the babies, all the boy babies in that area killed when they were 2 years old. And then the people tried to stone Jesus. You say, what is that? That's spiritual warfare. It's spiritual warfare. And here the Lord is on the cross and there's spiritual warfare getting on. Satan is trying to stop him from what he's doing. So look with me back in the book of 1 John, chapter number 3. And if you don't get there quick, I'm going to read it because I already have my place marked. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. He might destroy the works of the devil. And that's what he came for. He came to destroy the works of the devil. Look in Colossians chapter number 2. Colossians chapter number 2 and verse 13. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, has he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. And notice verse 15. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. So when the Lord Jesus died on the cross and rose again the third day, he made a show out of the devil and his followers. And finally, in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 10, the Bible says, the devil that deceived them was cast in the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. Now, in Revelation 20, Satan during the millennium, during that 1,000-year kingdom age, is going to be bound in that pit. And then the Bible says he'll be loose for a season and go out and deceive the nations. So he still has this work going on, but he is a defeated foe. He's already, his doom is already sealed, and Christ performed that on the cross. Let me say secondly, look back in Matthew 27 again. Matthew chapter number 27. And the Bible says, verse 51, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. And the earth quaked, and the rocks rent, and the graves were opened. Many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection. Nobody comes out of the grave until Jesus comes out of the grave. If Jesus doesn't come out of the grave, nobody ever does come out of the grave, because he's the first fruits of the resurrection. He's first one to be resurrection. So number one, on the cross, he defeats the devil. Number two, he rent the veil. Him's dying on the cross, shedding his blood, the veil of the temple is rent from the twain to the bottom. So if a man was going to rip that heavy veil, that heavy curtain, he'd rip it from the bottom. But it's ripped from top to bottom, meaning it's a work of God. Now, what is that talking about, that veil? Here's what it means. It means we can now go directly to God. We can come right to God, and we don't need an earthly priest, because we have a heavenly priest. Look with me over in the book of Hebrews. We could spend the rest of our time just roaming around in the book of Hebrews, because it has so much to do with the Lord and his heavenly mission, putting the blood on the mercy seat and becoming the mercy seat. Hebrews chapter number 4, and verse number 14, the Bible says, seeing then we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Notice verse 16, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Now, the Bible says he was tempted in all points, just like we are. What does that mean? The lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and pride of life. And we just went over that in Luke 4 and Matthew chapter 4. But notice how it says this. I love this. It says we can come boldly to the throne of grace. In the Old Testament, the priest The prophet represented God to the people. When God wanted to speak to the people, he would speak through a prophet. And it wasn't usually good news. The prophet represented God to the people. The priest represented the people to God. So you would have to go to the priest and take your sacrifice, and the priest would offer that sacrifice for you. He was your go-between. You didn't go directly to God. The Bible says now we can come boldly to the throne of grace. We don't need that earthly priest. We don't have an earthly priest. We have a heavenly priest. And I thank God for that. Look at Hebrews chapter number 7 and verse 25. Therefore is Abel also to save them to the uttermost to come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such a high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, who needeth not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered up himself. For the law maketh men high priests which have infirmity, but the word of the oath, which was since the law, maketh the Son, who is consecrated forevermore. Now, Jesus is a priest after the order, the Bible says, of Melchizedek, and his priesthood never ends. Look at Hebrews chapter number 10 and verse number 19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Look at that verse again. I believe that verse is talking about prayer. I believe it's talking about prayer, that we can come boldly to the throne of grace, and we can come to God through Jesus Christ. And that's the only way we can come to God, is through Jesus Christ. He is the one way. He's the one intercessor. He's the one mediator. Look over in 1 Timothy chapter number 2. In 1 Timothy chapter number 2, and verse number 3, this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. That's a strong verse there for the deity of Christ. The Bible says in Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Matthew chapter 1 says, call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. Who will have all men, notice verse 4, all means all, and that's all me all means. All men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. For there's one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. It's not the woman Mary. We have one intercessor between God and Mary. Between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself, notice, a ransom for all. A ransom for all. Hebrews 2:9 says he tasted death for every man. All right? So we can come boldly to the throne of grace, and we can come and we can pray and we come right before the Lord because he is ever living to make intercession for us. The Bible says in Ephesians 4, be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. So the only reason we can do what we do is because of what he did for us. So in the Old Testament, you had the high priest, and they had the daily sacrifices, and they were making all these offerings, and they had the tabernacle, and then they had the temple. The holiest day of the year in the Jewish calendar is the Day of Atonement. And on the Day of Atonement, the high priest, first he would make an offering for himself, and then one day out of the year, he would go into the Holy of Holies. He would go beyond that veil, and he would put that blood on the mercy seat, and he would confess the sins of Israel. And he did that one time, but he had to do it every year, every year, every year. The Lord Jesus, one time, he offers the blood and God accepts it, and that's a one-time sacrifice that covers everything forever. All right? In the Old Testament, the blood of bulls and goats could never take away sin. It was like buying time. Somebody had to pay the price. So he rent the veil, and He instituted the New Testament. Look at Hebrews chapter number 9. Hebrews chapter number 9 and verse 16. Where a testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. For a testament is of force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. Now, when we divide the Bible, we have the Old Testament and the New Testament. And the New Testament starts with Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the Gospels. But I want you to remember this, and we've talked about it. Some people have not heard this. The Lord Jesus Christ lived his whole life under the law as an Old Testament Jew, because the New Testament is not in force until Christ dies. Look at the verse I just read. A testament is must be a necessity, the death of the testator. Testament is a force after men are dead. Now, somebody can have a will and they can be leaving you $1 million, but you don't have a penny till they die, because that will is not going to be in force until that person dies. And that New Testament is not, Jesus kept the law. He lived under the law and he kept the law, and he's the only one that ever kept the law. So we're not under law. And let me make this statement. The law was never for Gentiles. The law was given by Moses, and it was given to the Jews, and it had a beginning and it had an end. And it didn't end when the book of Matthew begins. It ended when Christ died. Look in Matthew chapter number 26. And I feel like I'm up here just hollering at people because I'm trying to hurry. But Matthew chapter 26, and this is kind of, I wanted to sing that Mighty Fortress Is Our God, because it talks about Satan and how, you know, God just takes care of Satan. We're no match for Satan, but Satan's no match for him. So look at Matthew 26, verse 26. Matthew 26, 26. As they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." So we call this the Last Supper, okay? And he takes the bread and he says, "This is my body." Now, it represents his body. It's not his actual body. We're not cannibals. We don't eat his body. And nobody has the power to take a cookie and change it into the body of Christ. He took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it to them and said, "Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood," notice, "of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine." Never does say anywhere in the King James Bible we drink wine. The fruit of the vine, you know what that is? That's a grape juice. "Until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." So I wanted to read Ephesians chapter 2, but I don't have time to read it. But go with me to 1 John chapter 2, and I'll give you the last thought. Number one, he died on the cross and defeats the devil. Number two, we have access to God. We can come to God. We don't need to go to a saint, to go to Jesus, to go to God for us. We come right to God through Christ Jesus. And he instituted the New Testament. We're living in the dispensation of the grace of God. We have the New Covenant, the New Testament. And in 1 John chapter 2, "My little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he," Jesus Christ the righteous, "is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins," notice, "of the whole world." I don't have time to get on that. I'm not going to beat on anybody tonight. But the Bible says he's propitiation for our sins, meaning saved people, and the sins of the whole world. So the last point I'm making, the fourth point, is this. He, on the cross, became a propitiation for our sins. Now, that's a big word and a fancy word, but it means a satisfactory payment. A satisfactory payment. Now think about this. When Jesus died on the cross and shed his blood, He satisfied the righteous demands of God. Somehow we get this idea that when Jesus died, it was the devil that was had to be paid. God's righteousness, it's God's righteousness demanded a payment for sin. God doesn't overlook sin. God doesn't smile at sin. God doesn't ignore sin. Sin had to be paid for. And it had to be a satisfactory payment. And there was only one person could make that payment. And that is the Lord Jesus Christ. So the Bible says he is a propitiation for our sin. Go back with me one more time to Hebrews chapter number 10. Hebrews chapter number 10. And look at verse number 4. It's not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sin. The blood of bulls and goats in the Old Testament, the sacrifices, they pointed towards the cross. They pointed towards Christ. But again, I want to just say I give you an example like this, and it's just a crude example, but it'd be like putting something on your credit card, and you can get by for a while, but sooner or later you gotta pay that bill. And the Old Testament, those sacrifices didn't take away sin. They covered sin. There was an atonement there, but it didn't take away sin. When John the Baptist saw Jesus, he said this, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world." Even though the blood of bulls and goats can't take away sin, the blood of Jesus Christ did take away sin. So, look at verse 10. "By the which we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But this man," think about this, "after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God. For by one offering," verse 14, "he's perfected forever them that are sanctified." In the temple, in the tabernacle, there were no chairs because the priest never sat down because his work was never done. The Lord Jesus one time died on the cross for our sins. And the Bible says he sat down because his work was finished, because he paid for our sin. Amen. So a propitiation means this. It's satisfied. That idea is satisfying. If you've ever had a mortgage or some kind of a loan, it has to be satisfied. And that's the term they use. It's a legal term. And God's righteousness, God's holiness had to be satisfied. And there was only one way that could be done. And that was to pay the debt with the blood of Christ. The Bible says we're not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without spot and without blemish. So I thank the Lord for the cross. We glory in the cross, not the wood, not the structure, but what the Lord Jesus did on that cross. He died on the cross. He died for our sins, but he didn't stay dead. On the third day they went. The angel said, "Why seek ye the living among the dead? He's not here. He's risen." So that's for now.
Let's all stand to our feet. If you'd like to come and pray and thank the Lord for your salvation, why don't you step out right now? If you're here tonight and you don't know for sure, and I mean for sure, that if you were to die, that you'd go straight to heaven, the Bible says you can know that. You don't have to hope so. You don't have to think so. These things are written that you may know that you have eternal life. Jesus said you must be born again. There's got to be a time in your life when you stop trusting what you can do and you totally trust in what Christ already did on Calvary's cross. We're all sinners. We all deserve hell. But as we've heard preached tonight, Jesus paid for our sins. You could come to Christ tonight. You could trust Him tonight. With heads bowed and eyes closed, I wonder if there's anybody in the room tonight. You'd say, you know, I don't know I'm going to heaven. I'm concerned about my soul, and I need prayer. I won't embarrass you. I won't make you do anything. But I'll pray for you and give you an opportunity to trust Christ. Is there anybody here tonight? You'd say, I don't know I'm going to heaven. I'm concerned about my soul, and I need prayer. Would you raise your hand real high? I can see it. I'll pray for you tonight. Anybody at all? I don't know I'm saved. I don't know I'm going to heaven. Heather's here to my right. Brother Jason's to my left. If you need to be saved, step out from where you are and come to where they are. Privately and off to the side, in just a few moments, they could take a Bible. Show you from the Word of God how you could trust Christ. Be the greatest decision you've ever made in your life. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you're watching online tonight, you'd like to trust Christ. There's a phone number there on the screen. You can call that number. If you're a lady, we'll have a lady speak to you. A man, we'll have a man speak to you. Right over the phone, they could help you. You could trust Christ tonight. If you're a Christian, we ought to be so thankful for what Jesus did for us on the cross. Wonderful Bible thoughts tonight. We know them to be true because they're in the Scripture. If we have sin in our hearts, we need to be confessing that to the Lord. If you'd look this way as folks are closing here in prayer around the altar, in just a moment we'll have the Lord's Supper together. If you're a Christian, you're welcome to take part as we celebrate and commemorate the Lord's death on the cross and what all His sacrifice means to us. If you're a Christian and you are not in a place where you feel like you should take the Lord's Supper tonight for whatever reason, we don't need to know why. But if you know there's just reasons why you should not, you can either stay here or you could slip out in just a moment when we have prayer. Not being rude about it, but we don't force anybody to participate. If you're going to be participating in the Lord's Supper, you want to be right with God. None of us are perfect, but we shouldn't be living in unconfessed sin or open sin. The Bible teaches God will bring a judgment upon that. So we need to be right with the Lord. And if you're not saved, please don't participate this evening. We're going to have prayer. And as we have prayer, we're going to go offline at this time. At the conclusion of my prayer here to the Lord, we'll be offline. And thank you for those who joined us tonight by way of internet or those who watch this recording in the future. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you would help this time to be a time when we commemorate your death on the cross for us. Lord, we thank you, as we've just heard preach, for all that the cross means to us as Christian people. And God, again, if there's anyone here that's not saved or watching online that's not saved, I pray they come to Christ and trust Him. Please bless this time now. We pray in Christ's precious and holy and wonderful name. Amen.